just 5 6 minutes to focus on the plans of the Lyrical Ballads by Wordsworth and Coleridge. This is just a summary of what you are going to study in your book. So Wordsworth wrote all his ideas, all his theories in the preface to the Lyrical Ballads, and you've got the extract on page 278 of your book, of your literature book. While Coleridge wrote all his ideas about and the theories about the new conception of poetry in Biographia Literaria. So now let's focus very shortly on the two different tasks the poets gave to themselves, because they just sat down on a table drinking tea or coffee or probably pint of beer, and they discussed all this as a reaction against the artificial diction of the Augustan Age poetry. So they've got different tasks, different tastes, and different topics. They've chosen different topics, but the aim is more or less the same. So the aim is to, they wanted mankind to focus on their inner feelings, on their inner side, and to think about the importance of nature. So while Coleridge claimed that poetry should deal with supernatural persons and characters because they carried symbols and metaphors, Wordsworth chose incidents and situations from common life, for example, daffodils. We are going to study this poem. Daffodils are flowers. The aim of poetry for Coleridge is to give supernatural persons and characters a semblance of truth, while for Wordsworth, the aim of poetry was to give incidents and situations from common life, the charm of novelty, because we have forgotten the charm, we have forgotten the importance and the beauty of common life according to our habits, because we have lost ears and eyes, and we don't see anymore, and we don't hear anymore. Coleridge claimed that the means adopted to understand supernatural persons and character is the willing suspension of disbelief, which constitutes poetic faith. What does it mean? Well, very simply, it means that when you read a novel, when you read, for example, Harry Potter, you think that everything is real, because you suspend your disbelief. You are plunged into the book, plunged into the novel, you dive into the novel, and you are a character. You believe everything you are told, and you are happy to believe everything you are told, because you are immersed in another world. For Wordsworth, the means adopted and the task of the poet was to draw man's attention to the loveliness and wonders of nature, which we have forgotten. According to Coleridge, the poet's task was this. So the poet has to bring the soul of man into action with the help of imagination. Our soul, our good side, is sleeping. According to Wordsworth, the poet is a man speaking to man, but he is gifted with more lively sensitivity, more enthusiasm, tenderness and knowledge. So he's a sort of teacher who shows men how to improve their moral being. The language used by Coleridge is sometimes archaic, it's sometimes difficult to understand, but it is difficult because Coleridge wants us to think, to reflect. So the language is rich in metaphors and symbols. It carries natural images, which carry abstract meanings, supported by alliteration and rhymes. For example, the ancient mariner, the protagonist of the ballad we are going to study, is not a sailor. So it doesn't have the Anglo-Saxon root. It is not a common sailor. He is a mariner. This means that he's the symbol of the wise man who has made mistakes, who has gone through punishment and through repentance, and now he's doomed to tell his story to mankind in order to warn them against other mistakes and in order to teach them to respect God and nature. And this is very important to remember. Wordsworth used a selection of language used by men, but of course purified from what appeared to be its real defects. According to Coleridge, poetry is the power of exciting the sympathy of the reader by a faithful adherence to the truth of nature. What does it mean? This very simply means that poetry should wake us, our feelings, and to share, from the Greek sim pathos, to share the same feelings as the poet, and to wonder in front of nature, because we have forgotten the wonders of nature. So there is a wonderful sentence by Coleridge, which says, because we men and women, because we are following our habits every day, every morning, every night, we have forgotten the wonders of nature, and we've got eyes and yet see not, and ears and yet hear not. And this is very true, especially nowadays. Sorry. According to Wordsworth, poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. It takes its origin from emotion recollected in tranquility. What does it mean? This very simply means, for example, in his poems Daffodils, that the poet feels a strong emotion in front of nature, in front of a particular situation. He feels the strong emotion, but he goes home, he sits down and writes what he felt and what his emotions provoke in himself. And so the poem takes origin from the emotion he felt surrounded by nature, but recollecting in tranquility. And his task is to transmit those emotions, those feelings to mankind, in order to wake up mankind from the lethargy of our custom. And so I think, really think that Wordsworth and Coleridge were two geniuses. Coleridge, for example, nowadays would be called an ecologist, a green man fighting against big, powerful companies in order to respect nature. And Wordsworth, we can say, if he lived nowadays, he would fight for the poor people's right, for the common people. Okay, so this is just a very short summary and explanation about the project of about the plans of the Lyrical Ballads by William Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge.